Is this on? Good evening and thanks to all of you for joining us this evening for the launch of Lisa Ray's first book. Having read the book, I am certain that there'll be several more. And perhaps we'll all be gathering here every couple of years if AD would have us. When we received the book in office a couple of months ago, an early copy, a colleague of mine started reading it and came up to me and said, has she really written this? It's really good. I was instantly irritated, you know, the stereotypes we have about women, about beautiful women, about what women can achieve. And I stayed irritated with this colleague for a while. Also because I know, I mean, having met Lisa a couple of times over the last few years, I know how dedicatedly she was working on this book. I know she was at it since 2010. When I visited her flat in Bandra, she had this big fat manuscript on a desk in her bedroom, and it's all she wanted to talk about. So I knew she was perfectly capable of writing a good book. But then I read the book, and unfortunately, I had the same doubt as my colleague. Has she really written this? Because it's more than a good book. It's the kind of book that stirs you. It's the kind of memoir that does the heavy lifting for the reader to excavate their own synchronous emotions that Lisa writes about in the book, from love, ambition, hope, loss, insecurity, family, failure, all of it. Which is not to say it's all about emotion. There's a lot of masala in there for those who are looking for it. Right at the beginning, we have a young Lisa thwacking the son of an industrialist across his forehead with a shoe because he tried to grope her in his shoe closet. We have Lisa's formidable mother in a wheelchair accosting burglars who've entered their home saying, "You want to kill me? What's the worst you can do? Kill me right now." The burglar is sent running away. We have the underworld, we have a Mr. X, we have flirting with Sean Penn, which was not what I knew about earlier, at a Vanity Fair party. So, and there's this fabulous part that I call Lisa's Jab We Met moment with a happy ending. And I think before we even start the questions, I'd love for you to read that part, just to set the tone of you as a 16-year-old backpacker in Croatia, landing up at this doorstep.
Yes, thank you so much. And I also quickly wanted to say that having Anandita here today conducting this is a great honor. We're both of Bengali origin. And, you know, only if you are Bengali will you understand what I mean when we say that, you know, in the blood, in our genes, is contained this kind of a literary collage. You know, and even if you don't manifest it in your life, but I think somewhere we all aspire to have something to do with words. You know, it's something that's passed on to us, and it's considered perhaps the highest calling. And so, you know, I'm really greatly honored to have her here today and to be a champion of the book for a lot of the reasons also that she's mentioned, because I quickly wanted to say, of course, you know, there are certain perceptions of someone who has inhabited the business that I have inhabited for many years when I started at 16. And, you know, your image sort of calcifies at a certain point of time when you've been doing this as long as you have. Where the truth of the matter is, I've always been a misfit. I've always had this very strange, unique ability to sort of be, you know, inhabit a situation, and then a certain part of me is watching, to be an observer. And then I've always also had a notepad in my back pocket. And today, of course, it's maybe notes in my iPhone, but I've always taken notes. I've always been an observer of both my life and the life around me. So I've just been looking for an opening to be able to share my insights, my misadventures, and the many sort of triumphs and dark periods that I've been through. So Anandita, I'm gonna start with, where do you suggest I start? That this was 1991 and Yugoslavia, where had we said?
finally reached my destination in Croatia.
Yes.
Can I give you the part I've marked, if that's okay?
Okay. I'm just going
to
do that.
As much as you'd like to, and we can stop off.
I've got it right here. So yeah, so I was always rather rebellious, trying to challenge the conventions and the norms. So I decided that I was going to take off. My parents packed me off to Switzerland with sort of a guardian. And I decided that Switzerland felt a lot like Canada, which was boring and very sterile. So I decided spontaneously to buy a ticket to Croatia, to Yugoslavia. What was Yugoslavia at the time? To chase down this very cute boy that I knew back in Toronto.
Who had given you an open invitation, a vague kind of invitation.
A very vague invitation, you know, thinking that nobody's actually going to follow up on this vague invitation. I finally reached my destination in Croatia, a village close to Split, the largest coastal town in the country. It was early morning, the sun just breaking. When you fancy yourself a traveler and not a tourist, you develop a taste for disorienting arrivals. It's always early morning or late at night when you stumble into a new place and you are alone except for some solitary cab driver or another misfit like yourself. This very large feeling hits me on every arrival of this nature. I am an insignificant dot, a minuscule part of creation. I remember having one of those moments looking around that empty Croatian village. It was unkempt, like a wild girl gone to seed, bristly grass poking out from the gravel everywhere. Outside the whistle stop was the one taxi and a dusty road. The driver was dozing. I woke him and showed him my map. When I presented myself at Goran's door at 6 a.m., suitcase at my feet, the palest scale was behind me, turning me into a silhouette. Now that I was here, I had no idea what reception I would get. Goran was quite naturally surprised and sleepy, patting his hands over his hair self-consciously, but I was immediately welcome to stay. Yawning young faces emerged from inner rooms to gawk at me over Goran's shoulder. The house was full. There were cousins and kids with indecipherable ties. She's my mother's aunt's second cousin's daughter, spilling out of everywhere, but not a single adult. I was quickly absorbed into that youthful chaos, and under the gaze of so many eyes, Goran and I embarked on a whirlwind romance. After all, there's no spare room, so you're just going to have to sleep with me. He was an incredibly sexy guy, brooding with thick, dark, floppy hair. Almost every man I've been with since has possessed a variation on this look.
This is the cue for everyone to look at Jason right now, sitting in the front row.
But at the same time, I had just recently discovered boys in earnest. Goran's family's home was a Spartan but comfortable three-story house constructed of a simple whitewashed cement set on the side of a hill. Soon, word spread and most of the neighbors came by curious about this Canadian girl who had just shown up. Goran and I were trailed when we linked fingers and walked to the village center for coffee and to call my parents. The town seemed relatively prosperous. The small iron tables in the cafes were full, though no one seemed preoccupied with work. It was functioning on a typical Eastern European remittance economy where family members who had gone abroad sent money back to relatives who stayed behind. You could see the homes built from that money, slightly newer, slightly fresher, with television antennas, but still cinder block and whitewashed with a red roof. We would swim in the local swimming hole, a scenic bend in the river, where a large tree provided an overhanging branch from which the more adventurous boys would launch themselves into the water. It was a fine way for them to preen and show off. We'd walk for miles through cornfields, sometimes for no reasons, sometimes to visit an impressive hog. Goran's female cousin showed me how they made dolls out of corn stalks. At night, Goran and I slept on a mattress in the loft, whispering in the light of a battery-powered lantern. I remember lying very still next to Goran, holding in my happiness while the moon spilled drapes of light from a window set high under the roof.